بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، فإن أحسن الكلام كلام الله، وخير الهدى هدى محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وإن شر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. We start today hadith number 30 in An-Nawawi's 40 hadith, and this hadith is reported by Abu Tha'laba al-Khushani, Jurthum bin Nashir. And this companion, radiallahu anhu, he narrates that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in this hadith, إِنَّ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى فَرَضَ فَرَائِدَ فَلَا تُضَيِّئُوهَا. Indeed, Allah has made certain obligations. He's made certain obligations, فَرَائِد. So do not neglect them. And وَحَدَّ حُدُودًا فَلَا تَعْتَدُوهَا. And he has laid down limits, so do not transgress them. وَحَرَّمَ أَشْيَاءَ فَلَا تَنْتَحِكُوهَا. And he has made certain things haram, so do not violate them. وَسَكَتَ عَنْ أَشْيَاءَ رَحْمَةً لَكُمْ غَيْرَ نِسْيَانٍ فَلَا تَبْحَثُوا عَنْهَا. And he has remained silent about other things, out of mercy for you, not out of forgetfulness. So do not inquire into them, don't investigate into them. Now this hadith is reported by Ad-Darqutni, but it is one of the weak ahadith. As in An-Nawawi's 40 hadith, there are about five or six weak ahadith. They're da'if. They are not authentically ascribed to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and this is one of them. However, we see that in the hadith itself, everything that has been narrated in this hadith and ascribed to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, its meaning is correct. So even if we can't say that the messenger said this for certain, then the meanings are found in other texts in the Quran or the Sunnah. So for this reason, you see that the scholars, they'll continue to write explanations and, you know, explain the hadith, and because the asal or the foundation of it is found in other texts in any case. And that's the same with the other ahadith which are weak in An-Nawawi's 40 hadith as well. So this is one of those ahadith, so we should be aware of that we don't ascribe this as being the definite speech of the Messenger alayhi salam. We say that this hadith has been ascribed. This saying has been ascribed to the Prophet alayhi salam. It is da'if. However, the meanings are correct. So we start with Shaykh Ibn Uthaymeen, rahimahullah, and he says, first of all, he gives just the definitions and the meanings of each sentence. فرض إن الله تعالى فرض فرائض فرض, which means to make something obligatory and which is definitely obligatory. There's no doubt about it. And فرض فرائض, that Allah made certain things obligations, the فرائض, and this is like the five prayers, the zakah, the fasting, the hajj, birr al-walidain, being righteous and good to your parents, and keeping the ties of family, the ties of kinship, keeping them bound together, and all the other things which have been made obligatory, fard. فَلَا تُضَيُّعُوهَا, do not neglect them. So we've been commanded not to neglect them, rather you should safeguard them. وَحَدَّ حُدُودًا فَلَا تَعْتَدُوهَا, and Allah has set down limits, do not transgress them. And the word had, the meaning of had, which is the singular of hudud, it literally means a barrier. And a barrier is like when you, the Shaykh explains that when you have, you know, barriers on the land or in a field or whatever, and it prevents you from going past into the other field or the other area. So this is, or a barrier is to prevent, like a wall, to prevent someone from going into, you know, the next area. This is a barrier. So what is meant here, the Shaykh says, the hudud of Allah, Allah has laid down limits, do not transgress them. Then he's speaking about the things which he made wajib and the things which he made haram. His obligations and the things which he made unlawful. So do not transgress and go beyond them. And then the Shaykh goes on to explain that that the word hudud is also used to refer to the Sharia punishments. The punishments in the Sharia for certain sins or crimes. Like, for example, the punishment for fornication, committing zina, or the punishment for stealing, and so on. And the Shaykh says what is correct in this hadith of the meaning hudud, or the meaning had, like the limits of Allah, it refers to the wajibat and the muharramat. That which is wajib and that which is haram, do not transgress and go beyond them. That's what the meaning of hudud is in this particular hadith. And then the Shaykh explains that in the Quran, we find that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned, he says, تِلْكَ حُدُودُ اللَّهِ فَلَا تَقْرَبُوهَا. These are the limits of Allah, do not therefore approach, do not approach them. And Allah is speaking about eating and drinking when fasting. Right? So eating and drinking is something that Allah has made unlawful, haram. And then Allah said, تِلْكَ حُدُودُ اللَّهِ. These are the limits of Allah. This proves that the limits of Allah being referred to here in this hadith is the actual prohibition. So a had, the limit, is the actual prohibition. So here in this example, to not drink and to not eat is the had, is the prohibition of Allah as it relates to fasting. This is why Allah said, تِلْكَ حُدُودُ اللَّهِ. These are the limits of Allah. فَلَا تَقْرَبُوهَا. Do not approach them or come near to them. And in another verse, Allah says regarding al-iddah, which is the waiting period when a woman gets divorced. So when a divorce is pronounced, then there is a waiting period. And so when Allah is speaking about the rules and regulations to do with al-iddah, then Allah said, تِلْكَ حُدُودُ اللَّهِ فَلَا تَعْتَدُوهَا. These are the limits of Allah, so therefore do not transgress them. So this is a proof to show that an obligation itself and something which is haram itself, these are the hudud. These are the hudud of Allah. These are the limits of Allah which we are not allowed to approach or to transgress. Right, this is a proof. And then the Shaykh goes on to explain in the hadith, وَحَرَّمَ أَشْيَاءَ, that Allah made certain things haram. فَلَا تَنْتَحِكُوهَا, so do not violate them. So those things which are haram, things like fornication, things like adultery, things like falsely slandering a woman of something she is innocent of, and other such things, all of these are haram. And anything which is haram is, you know, is something that should not be violated. Then the Messenger said, as occurs in this hadith, وَسَقَتَ عَنْ أَشْيَاءَ رَحْمَةً لَكُمْ غَيْرَ نِسْيَانٍ فَلَا تَبْحُثُوا عَنْهَا. And Allah has remained silent about certain other things, out of mercy for you, not out of forgetfulness, so therefore do not investigate into them. Meaning Allah never spoke about certain things, never mentioned anything about certain things. So therefore do not start, you know, he didn't make them haram, nor did he make them fard, or wajib. He didn't mention anything about them. So don't, you know, so don't investigate into them. And in the hadith it says, غَيْرُ نِسْيَانٍ, meaning without being forgetful. Meaning Allah didn't remain silent about these things because he was forgetful. No, it's because he kept silent from them out of mercy upon you, not out of forgetfulness. And then the Shaykh mentions the verse, وَمَا كَانَ رَبُّكَ نَسِيًّا, that your Lord is not one to forget. Allah does not forget. So those things which Allah kept silent about was because He is merciful to His creation, not because He forgot to mention anything, be that haram or be that wajib. فَلَا تَبْحَثُوا عَنْهَا, therefore do not investigate into them, meaning don't ask about them, and don't, you know, rather leave them and don't investigate into them. So here the Shaykh just mentioned a very brief explanation of the hadith, and we see that there are four things in this hadith. First of all, there are fara'id, there are obligations which are not to be neglected. Don't neglect them. Rather safeguard them. Number two, there are certain limits, hudud, which are not to be transgressed. And these hudud are the prohibitions and the obligations. They're not to be transgressed. Number three, there are certain things which have been made haram, so do not violate them, or do not enter into them. And number four, there are certain things about which there is silence. The Sharia, Allah did not mention anything about them, so do not start investigating into them. So these are, if you like, four general principles for a person as to how he should behave with what has come in the Sharia. Things which are obligatory, things which are from Allah's limits, things which are unlawful, and things about which there has been nothing said at all. How does a Muslim behave in all of these, you know, different situations? So the Shaykh then, he goes on to mention the benefits. What benefits can we take from this hadith? What are the fawaid? What are the benefits? So inshallah we'll work through these. The first of them is, first of all, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He alone is the one who makes something obligatory. He alone is the one who makes something fard, or the one who makes something wajib, and He's the one who makes something haram. The right for this belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's in His hand alone. And nobody besides Allah can declare something to be wajib, or something to be haram, or even something to be mustahab, or whatever else, except with a proof, except with something from which Allah Himself has revealed. And the proof that Allah is the one who obligates is in the hadith, because Allah said, or the Messenger said, as is ascribed to him in this hadith, إِنَّ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى فَرَضَ فَرَائِدًا وَحَدَّ حُدُودًا وَحَرَّمَ أَشْيَاءً. So all these things are ascribed to Allah. Allah is the one who made obligatory. Allah is the one who laid down the limits. Allah is the one who made something haram. So this right belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. And now the next question is, that the Shaykh discusses, is the meaning of fard and the meaning of wajib. Because we hear both of these words. We hear fard, sometimes we hear the word fard, sometimes we hear the word wajib. So what is the explanation? And are these words the same, or are these words different? The Shaykh goes on to explain this. He says, first of all, some of the scholars, they have different views. Some of them say that al-fard is anything which Allah has made obligatory in the Quran. In the Quran. Because the Quran, as a whole, it is what we call qat'i, meaning that the Quran is absolutely certain. Meaning every single verse in the Quran has come to us in a very certain, definite way. Meaning it's authentic, without any shadow of doubt, the Quran. So anything which Allah has made obligatory, then some of the scholars are of the view, meaning in the Quran, that this is what we call something which is fard. And anything which is in the Sunnah is what is called wajib. This is the view of some of the scholars. It's one view. And the Shaykh says what is correct, actually, is the correct view the Shaykh explains is that the meaning of fard and wajib is the same, but when we have an obligation which is emphasized, it has a strong emphasis placed upon it in the Sharia, then that then becomes a farida, meaning it's fard. Then we speak about it as being a fard, meaning something which is an emphasized obligation. It is an obligation, a wajib, which is emphasized. And the Shaykh says this is the most correct view on this issue, and we will probably discuss this in a bit more detail when we look at the next explanation of Sheikh Salih al-Sheikh. Then the Shaykh goes on to say, the second benefit here is that the religion of Islam is divided into the fara'id and the muharramat. So when we look at the religion of Islam, we find either it is something which is fard, an obligation, a series of obligations, or a series of prohibitions. And this is what makes up the entire Sharia. And this is the second one. The third benefit is the obligation to safeguard the fara'id of Allah. That a Muslim must safeguard the fara'id of Allah. Because the Messenger said, فَلَا تُضَيِّئُوهَا. Do not neglect them. And this is a command, clear command, to safeguard and protect the fara'id. Meaning, one's prayers, one's fasting, the Hajj, when one is able to do Hajj and has the means, and giving the charity, all these things which are emphasized, the fara'id, upon what Shaykh explained, and likewise the righteousness to the parents, and all those things which are from the fara'id, which we find in the Qur'an, in the sunnah, are emphasized obligations. Next benefit is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He made certain limits, the hudud. And this means, as we've explained, that Allah made that which is wajib to be clear, and that which is haram to be clear. I mean, these things are clear, defined limits. And the Shaykh explained, this is just like you have limits placed upon the earth. You have, to give an illustration, this is like if you have, you live in a house, and your house has four boundaries, and it has four fences, or four walls, and you know that these are the boundaries, so therefore you can't jump over into your neighbor's backyard or his garden and have a barbecue. And you can't, send your kids onto the over the wall to the next door neighbor's house with a football and let them play football. You know you can't do this. And you would, if you were to do that, you would feel strongly and inherently that you are doing something terribly wrong. You are transgressing upon someone else's right. And you are violating someone else's right. You would know this and you would perceive this when you think of the situation in this manner. So therefore, you have a house, you have limits, and you know that you do not transgress them. In the same way, Allah, He has set limits, and these limits are His obligations and those things which He made haram. So therefore, when you transgress those limits and you fall into something which is haram, or you don't fulfill that which is wajib upon you, then you are in the same situation as one who jumps over his wall or his fence and starts using his neighbor's garden, or who sends his kids over the other fence and lets them, use the garden of the neighbor. The same thing, same thing. So therefore, these limits that Allah has made, these limits are there to be observed, not to be transgressed, and you are violating Allah's limits when you enter into them. This is how a person should think about them. And we find in another hadith that the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, hadith that we looked at earlier, أن الحلال بين والحرام بين وبينهما أمور مشتبهاتٌ, that the halal is clear and the haram is clear, meaning that Allah has made the haram and the halal to be clear to everybody. His limits are known and clear and explained, and between them are doubtful matters. So that's the fourth benefit. We should understand that this is the nature of Allah's limits, Allah's prohibitions, Allah's obligations, and this is how we should see them. Number five, the prohibition of transgressing against the limits of Allah. Because in the hadith, it is mentioned, فَلَا تَعْتَدُوهَا, do not transgress the limits. It's prohibited. And we looked at in the Qur'an, there were two examples given in the Qur'an. The first example was fasting. Allah mentioned fasting, not eating, not drinking. Then He said, these are the limits of Allah, therefore do not approach them. And Allah gave another example, second example, of divorce and the waiting period in divorce. And He mentioned certain laws and regulations to do with divorce. And then He said, these are the limits of Allah, do not transgress them. So, from this, from the hadith, the next benefit the Shaykh mentions is that the fact that these rulings were mentioned and then Allah's hudud were mentioned next to them or in relation to them, then this shows, or it shows, the emphasis of the prohibition of transgressing Allah's limits. Number six, the sixth benefit is that when we understand what Allah, what has been mentioned in this hadith and in those verses, not to transgress the limits of Allah, this even applies also to the actual punishments that Allah has specified. So we know there are certain punishments which Allah has specified for certain sins, like fornication and adultery, and falsely accusing someone, a chaste woman, and making a false slander upon her, and other things, and stealing or whatever. There are certain limits, certain punishments that have been mentioned in the Sharia. So when someone implements those punishments, then even in those punishments, a person is not allowed to transgress the limits. Right? So now we understand what's going on here. We have those limits which are Allah's prohibitions and Allah's obligations. These are hudud as well. And then there are those hudud which are the punishments that Allah has prescribed for certain sins. Even in those punishments, we are not allowed to transgress. So as an example, the Shaykh says, the punishment for someone who fornicates, he commits fornication, commits zina, is that he should be given 100 lashes. And then in the view of some scholars, that he should be exiled, he should be sent away from the land for 1 year. But it's not permissible then to say, well, you know, we should give him 150 to make an example of him, or we should give him 200 to make an example of him. This is not permissible, because the hudud of Allah are defined and fixed. No one can change the hudud of Allah. No one can transgress the hudud of Allah. And the Shaykh says, if someone was to say, you know, why are we just giving him 100? You know, why don't we give more? Why don't we give 200? And then, you know, if we give 200, maybe the people won't commit zina. This is wrong. This is because the Shaykh is saying, we say to this person, are you more knowledgeable than Allah? Because Allah, as long as Allah has specified specifically that there is 100 lashes, then that's what we stick to. And Allah knows best. Allah has specified that because He knows best. And so we don't start, you know, transgressing the limits of Allah in this manner. And likewise, the Shaykh then mentions a side issue, which is that the punishment for drinking is not a had, right? And the proof for it is that the scholars or the Sahaba, they differed as to how much should someone who drinks, how many lashes should he receive. Some say 40, some say 80. So this is a proof to show that the punishment for drinking, that there is no had in the Quran and the Sunnah, as in it is not one of the had punishments, like for example the had punishment for adultery or murder or fornication. You know, these things have specifically defined had punishments in the book and the Sunnah. But as for drinking, then it is not a had punishment, it is what we call ta'zir. Ta'zir means, if you like, an admonition. You know, something like, it's a punishment to rectify a person and to make an example of him. This is what is called the ta'zir. It's not a had punishment. So some scholars say that it is 40, we give him 40. And some other scholars say it is 80, that we give him 40 as a punishment, and another 40 as a, you know, like an exemplary punishment. So the Shaykh is basically explaining that the punishment given to the one who drinks intoxicants, then it is not to be considered as a had. Although some scholars, they are of the view that it is a had punishment. But what is most correct, and what is most correct is that it is not a had punishment. The next benefit, number 7, is that Allah has been described with sukut, which is silence, that Allah remains silent. So this is established as, an attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, even though this hadith is da'if, however, the scholars, when we look into the books of Aqidah, we find that some of the scholars, they mention it from other proofs in the Quran and the Sunnah, that Allah is to be described with, or has the attribute of silence. And this is because Allah speaks whenever He wills, and He speaks, and if He wishes, He does not speak. This is down to Allah's will. Allah speaks whenever He wills, and this proves that Allah, if He wishes, He will not speak, meaning remain silent. And if He speaks, then He can choose to speak. This is a proof to show that the attribute of as-sukut, silence, is something that is affirmed for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we find this in the books of hadith. Or in the books of aqidah, sorry. In the books of aqidah, in which the scholars discuss this. The next benefit is that Allah has made it haram upon a person to violate His sanctities, the maharim. The maharim is Allah's sanctity. And this is just like the example I gave to you earlier on about, you know, you have a house and you have a neighbor on this side, neighbor on that side, and you have your fence and you have your wall. Then you know the boundaries, you know, you're not allowed to go on to his side and on the other side. These are the boundaries. So same way, Allah's prohibitions are the maharim. This is Allah's, if you like, the sanctity of Allah. the sanctities of Allah. So we're not allowed to enter into them. And when we look in the Quran, we find that Allah makes things haram in different ways. There are three ways. Number one, Allah will explain a clear prohibition. A clear prohibition. Do not do such and such. Do not steal. Do not do whatever. This is a clear prohibition. This shows it is haram. Number two, Allah will mention a punishment. So if you do such and such, you will receive a punishment. That in itself is a proof that that thing is haram. Right? Because a punishment is attached to it, it means it is haram. And number three, Allah will explicitly say that Allah has made unlawful upon you. You know, harrama, Allah has made lawful upon you. Say, my Lord has made unlawful, al-fawahish, the shameful deeds or whatever. So it will be clearly mentioned that Allah has made something unlawful. So these are the different ways we come to know that something is from the maharim, from the sanctities of Allah that is not allowed to be violated. The next benefit, number nine, is that whatever Allah has kept silent about, He has not mentioned that it is fard, He's not mentioned that it is wajib, He's not made any had, not made any limit, then all of that is halal. We treat everything to be halal. Whatever Allah has not spoken of, He's not said that it's fard, He's not said it's wajib, not said it's haram, not mentioned any punishment with respect to it, then it is halal. However, this is only in something which is not ibadah. So you need to pay attention to this now. This only applies in anything which is not ibadah. As for something which is ibadah, then Allah has made everything to be haram, except what Allah Himself has legislated to be from ibadah. So we need to be very, very clear about this. So let's go through this again. Whatever Allah has kept silent about, Allah has not said anything about it, Allah has not made it haram, nor has He made it wajib or fard or whatever, then that thing we treat it to be halal. It's permissible for a person to act upon that or whatever, eat or whatever. It is halal. But this rule only applies to anything which is not ibadah, not worship. As for worship, then everything is haram unless we find a proof for it in the book and the sunnah. Unless Allah or His Messenger have legislated that particular worship. So we should be clear about this. And this is why the Shaykh says, we say that anyone who innovates anything into the deen of Allah, into the religion of Allah, something which doesn't belong to it, he brings something, whether it's a belief, he innovates or he brings a new belief, or he brings a new statement or a new action, a new worship, then this person, what has he done? He has entered into the maharim of Allah. He has entered into that which is haram. Why? Because from those things which are haram is to bring something in the deen of Allah which Allah has not given permission for. This is in the Quran, that have they legislated something for which Allah has not given them permission. So the Shaykh then continues and he says that he now discusses an issue to give an example of this. This example is of removing hair. Removing hair. Can a woman remove hair from the legs or from the body, or even likewise a man? Can you remove bodily hair from the arms or from the legs or from the chest? Because this is an issue that relates to this, something which Allah has kept silent about. So the Shaykh now is going to give this example to illustrate what is meant. He says, so first of all, he mentions the issue, is it permissible for a person to remove the hair from his shin or from his arm? And so the Shaykh says that the hair is of three types. There are three types of hair. First of all, the first one, which Allah has commanded that we remove it. This is the first type. The second type is which Allah has commanded that we do not remove it, that we've been prohibited from removing it. And the third type is that which Allah has remained silent about. Then he gives the examples. So the first one is that which Allah has ordered that we remove the hair. The then this is the pubic hair. This is the hair that we have underneath the armpits, in between the legs. And likewise for a male, for a man, he trims the moustache. Trimming of the moustache. He trims the moustache. So this is something which is wajib. It is obligatory that this is removed. However, the Shaykh says that with a moustache, it's not completely removed as in shaving, rather it is trimmed. It is trimmed. And it is prohibited to completely shave the moustache. In fact, the Shaykh mentions that Imam Malik, rahimahullah, he said that the one who used to shave the moustache, he used to be disciplined, meaning that he used to be given some sort of exemplary punishment, or he's to be told off, basically, you know, because the hadith says, "Ahfu ash-shawarib," meaning the meaning is that you trim the moustache, not that you shave the moustache. This is for men. Anyway, this is for men. That's the first type of hair, the hair which is obligatory to remove. The second type is the hair which is prohibited to remove. It's haram to remove that hair, and this is for the men, the beard. Because for a man it is obligatory to keep the beard. And the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, he ordered, Khalifu al-Majus. Differ from the Majus, the Magians, the fire worshippers. Why? Because from their habit used to be that they used to shave their facial hair, the beard. And likewise he said, Khalifu al-Mushrikeen. Differ from the Mushriks, the pagans. Why? Because the quality or the characteristic of the pagans is to shave the beard. So this type of hair is prohibited for anyone to remove. And the Shaykh says, then he speaks of another issue, which is that some of the jurists, some of the scholars, they make it permissible to remove from the beard anything which is more than a fistful or a fist length, like this. They make it permissible to remove like that. This is the view of some of the scholars. And the Shaykh says the proof for this is the action of Umar, Ibn Umar radiallahu anha. And the Shaykh says, although some scholars hold this view, it opposes the clear text. The clear text says, leave the beard, let the beard flow. And the Shaykh also explains that Ibn Umar, that he only did this in the period of Hajj, or when he did Hajj or Umrah. So, because we've been commanded to take something off of the hair, then he would then remove something from the beard as part of that. So this is how the Shaykh says, this is how we understand the hadith of Ibn Umar. But as for generally speaking, in general, then it is to be left and not to be trimmed or shortened. And so this is what the Shaykh explains. And the Shaykh then goes on to the third type of hair, and this is the hair where we don't find any command nor any prohibition. So we don't see anything in the book of the Sunnah mentioned about the hair on the arm, the hair on the chest, the hair on the legs. There's nothing mentioned about this, whether for male or for females. So now, what is the ruling upon this? What is the ruling upon this? The Shaykh says that there are some scholars who are of the view that they say it is haram for this to be removed, and they use a general proof, which is when Shaitan Iblis, when he said about mankind, he will say, وَلَأَمُرَنَّهُمْ فَلْيُغَيِّرُنَّ خَلْقَ اللَّهِ, that I will certainly command them and they will change the creation of Allah. Right? So they use this general proof. This is a general proof to show that Iblis will come and he will change the creation of mankind. He will change their appearance. He will change, he will make them change themselves. And the Shaykh says that from this, there are certain exceptions, obviously, like circumcision and like those things which Allah has ordered, like the removal of the pubic hair, like we mentioned earlier on. These are exceptions. But everything else, based upon what Iblis said, then it would be considered to be changing the creation of Allah. So they say, therefore, that removing the hair on the arms and the chest and the legs, whatever, that this is changing the creation of Allah. And so what the Shaykh says is, that this reasoning or this proof is something which is correct, although he says that there are certain things, you know, there are certain things which would be an exception, and so he gives an example is, say for example, amongst women, where you have something which is not in keeping with their womanhood. So they have excessive hair, for example, facial hair, or, you know, excessive hair on the legs, whatever. In that case, it is not normal. And so for that reason, it is permissible for them to remove that hair. And this is the view of other scholars as well. They make it permissible for women to remove the facial hair, you know, which is not really from the signs of womanhood, rather it's from the sign of manhood. So because that would mean resemblance, then some of the scholars use this as a proof to say that it is permissible for the women to remove, you know, facial hair and whatever. And the sheikh, this is what the sheikh says, that that you know, the exception to this is when, in relation to the women, when it becomes confusing and you see characteristics which are those of men, and we see that women are, you know, supposed to be beautiful and supposed to beautify themselves and adorn themselves, then in that case, فَلَا بَأْسَ, there's no harm. As for men, then the sheikh says, as for men, then plenty of hair is a sign of the strength and the manhood. It's a sign of the manhood of a man. So the sheikh here, he's used this example to illustrate how that there are some things that Allah has remained silent about, and he's just illustrating this you know, with this example. Benefit number 10 is that Allah, that it is not befitting that we start investigating into things that Allah has not mentioned, that Allah has remained silent about. And the shaykh then says, is this to be understood that this only takes place in the time of the Prophet, or is it after the time of the Prophet ﷺ as well? Meaning this prohibition. So the shaykh says, the scholars differ on this. There are a number of different sayings among the scholars. So the scholars, some scholars say that this applies only to the time of the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ, meaning whilst the revelation was coming down. And so it was prohibited for a person to start asking about certain things in case it was made haram. In case it was made haram. And so the example is that the Shaykh brings is that one of the companions called Al-Aqra bin Habis, he asked the Prophet ﷺ about the Hajj. He said that the Prophet ﷺ said, indeed, Allah has made the Hajj fard upon you. He's made it obligatory upon you. So this companion, he stood up, Al-Aqra, and he said, O Messenger of Allah, is this in every year? Does this apply every year? And the Shaykh says, now this question is out of its place. You know, you shouldn't really have asked this place. You shouldn't really have asked this question. The only reason you should have asked this question is if the speech of the Messenger wasn't clear to him. Wasn't clear to him. But here, the Messenger simply said, Allah's made Hajj fard upon you. So, you know, in case he misheard it, then clearly he should have asked the question. But the question itself is out of place. Then the Prophet answered, he said, if I had said yes, it would have become obligatory and you would not have been able to fulfill this. Meaning, if the Messenger said to him, yes, it is obligatory in every year, this would have created a huge burden upon people. Imagine, you know, having to perform Hajj every single year with all of the cost and with the children of young age and whatever, and the elderly, whatever, it would be a huge burden upon everybody. So this shows, the Shaykh then says, you know, who is greater in crime than someone who asks about something, and as a result of asking, it then becomes wajib upon the people. And so this is why, you know, in relation to this hadith, that anything which the Sharia has kept silent about, then do not ask about it. And so the scholars say that this is in the time when the revelation was coming down, the people were prohibited from asking about things. Rather, they should wait up until the revelation comes. As for after the prophethood, after the messengership, then the Shaykh says, he says that there's no harm in a person investigating into what is haram. However, the Shaykh says, still, this issue of questioning and asking and investigating things which are haram, he says that this again is something that is not really something that is desirable. And he gives an example. He says, when we have these meats which come, there are certain meats and cheeses which come into the country. Now obviously you've got to understand here that the example that the Shaykh is giving is the example of the meat of the people of the book. And, you know, he's talking about the meat coming into that country. And so the Shaykh is obviously of the view that the meat of the people of the book today is halal, as are the other scholars. And you know, the meat that comes from the bilad al-kuffar, he says fala tubhath. He says they're not to be, we don't investigate into them. We don't start saying, is it halal, is it haram, or whatever. And then he gives the example of Ibn Umar, who said, when he was asked about the meat in the market, he said, whatever meat is in our market, we shall buy from it, and we are not going to ask. He's quoting a statement of Ibn Umar. And likewise, he says, so he gives this example, but obviously this issue has a lot of lengthy discussion to it, but that's the view of the Sheikh and the scholars in general. And but as I said, this is a separate issue, a lengthy issue on its own. We don't want to delve into it here. But the Sheikh then goes on to give another example where this applies, which is to do with Allah's names and attributes. Because this is from the knowledge of the unseen. And whatever Allah has told us of His names, Allah is Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim, Al-Malik, Al-Quddus, and so on and so forth, and His attributes that we find in the Quran, we believe in them, we accept them. But anything which Allah has not mentioned, then we don't start asking and delving and inquiring and researching and asking questions and whatever. This is not what we do. And the Shaykh then says, he says, there are other people as well, they start inventing situations. Situations that don't even exist. So they say, for example, well, if a man was to such and such, and then such and such happened, and then such and such whatever, would that be haram or halal? In other words, they're inventing a situation. And you find a lot of people, they ask questions like this, ridiculous questions. Questions which don't even have any application. They have no benefit at all. And, you know, they've got no practical benefit at all. And, you know, from one of the common ones, people come and say, what's our belief regarding dinosaurs? Or what's our belief regarding, you know, what do we say? Well, this is of no relevance. We're not required to have any belief about that which happened, you know, thousands or millions or whatever. This is from the ghaib. And, okay, things like this may have existed, they're just animals, whatever, but so what? You know, what are you asking about these things? And then other such things to do with science and whatever, from the ghaib, from the unseen, which we have no knowledge of. I don't ask about these things. Is there life on other planets? Why are you asking these questions for? You know, this doesn't affect you. Doesn't affect your ibadah. Doesn't affect your religion. This is from the ghaib. This is from the unseen. Allah hasn't told you anything about it. You know, we know there's jinn. We know there's angels. We know there's mankind. So people, what they do is they ask questions about things which are from the ghaib, which have no benefit, or even they invent certain scenarios and situations and start asking and investigating, and, you know, all of this is a distraction. And in light of, in this hadith, what has been ascribed to the Prophet ﷺ, that whatever, you know, this is how we treat this situation. And the Shaykh, he then goes on to give another example of the adhan. He gives an example of the adhan that Uthman, he added a second adhan to the Jum'ah prayer. And this is because as the city of Medina was expanding, and so therefore he made the Mu'adhin give an adhan earlier, about maybe an hour earlier, and then the actual adhan just prior to, like, when the Imam comes. So Uthman, he brought in this adhan for that purpose. And so the Shaykh says, some people come along and start saying, this adhan, you know, is it, you know, these two adhans, what's the time difference between them? Is it 2 minutes? Is it 3 minutes? Is it half an hour? Is it whatever? And should it be this and should it be that? And then they start investigating all these little particular details. And the Shaykh says, this is wrong, because the whole purpose behind the adhan is that as the town expands, then people need time to come to the Jum'ah prayer. And it's based upon that, to give people enough time. And so this will vary from town to town and place to place and whatever. You might have a relatively small town which, you know, is one adhan. might be another town which has, you know, much larger, so people need to be told in advance. So the Shaykh says that this is how it is, so you don't start investigating and delving into all these little questions and whatever that have not really been discussed by the scholars themselves. You know, whatever the scholars themselves have remained silent about in these issues, then you don't start delving into those kind of things. So the Shaykh then gave that as an example, and then he moves on to the next benefit, which is Allah's Rahmah. In this hadith is a proof for Allah's Rahmah, that Allah has the attribute of mercy. And from Allah's mercy is that the reward for a deed is much more than the deed itself. This is from Allah's mercy, that Allah rewards you with a deed which is much more, that Allah rewards you, which is much more than the deed itself. Why? Because when a person does a good deed, he is given anything from 10 times that deed to 700 times that deed in reward. And this is from Allah's mercy. When you do a deed, Allah returns it, but by at least 10 times more. This is from Allah's mercy. And also from Allah's mercy is that He kept silent about certain things. And this is also from Allah's mercy. He didn't make things obligatory upon us, nor did He make those things prohibited upon us. Rather, He kept silent. And that is from Allah's mercy. Next benefit is that we deny that Allah forgets. Allah does not forget. Because in this hadith, the Messenger said, غَيْرُ أَوْ غَيْرَ نِسْيَانٍ, meaning Allah didn't mention certain things, not because He was forgetful. And we see the same meaning in the Quran, وَمَا كَانَ رَبُّكَ نَسِيَّا, your Lord is not one to forget. So this proves that forgetting is negated from Allah. And likewise, in another verse, when Musa alayhi salam, he said to Fir'aun, قَالَ عِلْمُهَا عِنْدَ رَبِّي فِي كِتَابٍ لَا يَضِلُّ رَبِّي وَلَا يَنْسَى. This is when Fir'aun, he asked Musa about the previous nations. And Musa said, the knowledge of them is with my Lord in a book. My Lord does not err, nor does He forget. He does not forget. Now, there's a question the Shaykh mentions here, is that how can we explain this with another verse in the Quran when Allah says, نَسُوا اللَّهَ فَنَسِيَهُمْ. Allah says that they forgot Allah, so Allah forgot them. How can we explain this? The answer is that here Allah, that the word forgetting in Arabic, when we speak of nisyan in Arabic, it has two meanings. The first meaning is to actually forget, to be unheedful or unmindful, to forget something. And the second meaning is to deliberately abandon and turn away from someone, to forget someone. This is the second meaning. And both of these are meanings in the Arabic. So in the first verses that we looked at, وَمَا كَانَ رَبُّكَ نَسِيَّا, your Lord is not one to forget, then he's negating that Allah ever forgets. And in the second one, نَسُوا اللَّهَ فَنَسِيَهُمْ, they forgot Allah, so Allah forgot them. This means that they abandoned Allah's religion, so Allah then abandoned them. They forgot Allah's religion, they forgot Allah, so Allah forgot them. Meaning Allah deliberately abandoned them and forgot them. And so the forgetting which is negated from Allah is the one which is, you know, what we suffer from. We fail to remember something, we forget something, we are unheedful of something, unmindful of something. All of that is completely negated for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. However, Allah can deliberately abandon certain people when they abandon His deen, when they abandon His religion, and all of that, you know, is from Allah's perfection and His wisdom and His justice. And finally, the final benefit that the Shaykh mentions is that look at the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, how in this hadith he presented it in a manner where he clarified everything. He gave a taqseem, he gave a classification, meaning that he made it easy to understand and made it very clear. So he said that there are certain things which Allah has made fard, don't neglect them, safeguard them. There are certain things that He has made, or there are certain limits that He's placed, don't transgress them. There are certain things which He's made haram, don't fall into them. And certain things that He's kept quiet about, don't inquire into them. So it's a very clear, you know, taqseem, clear division. And so this is from the signs of the excellent teaching and the excellent clarification of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. And obviously that's upon what we clarified at the very beginning, that this hadith is actually da'if. So we are working on the assumption that it's simply ascribed to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. And also that despite that, These meanings are all found in the book and the sunnah in other places in any case. So that's the end of the Shaykh's explanation. Inshallah, we'll stop the lesson here today. We'll continue with the explanation of Shaykh Salih Ali Sheikh in the next lesson, inshallah ta'ala. And with that we finish. SubhanAllahumma wa bihamdika ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.